Are you okay with that? I'll do it if you'll read the scripture. I'll do all the offering and everything. Thank you. This morning, aren't we? Good morning. Great to see all of you out this morning. We're on the verge of a new year. Surprise, surprise. Not really sure what happened to 2023, but it seems like we're upon the edge of a coming new year. Expectations for the new year. We're looking forward. God calls us to many things. He will place us in many situations for his purposes. But I encourage all of you this year, be expectant. Be expectant for what he's going to do in your life, in all of our lives, the lives of this church. We're looking forward with expectations, hopefully shortly, of a full-time pastor. So just keep praying. Keep praying, and we'll carry on. We'll minister. We'll spread the good news according to our opportunities and those things that we're called to do. A couple of announcements this morning. Just found out a little while ago, Kay Cook passed away yesterday afternoon at around 4 o'clock. Kay was the wife of one of our previous ministers, Engel Cook, but keep the family of Kay Cook in your prayers, if you would. Also, tomorrow, New Year's Day, the luminaries that are in the cemetery, they will start picking those up at 11 o'clock tomorrow. So if you have a little bit of free time tomorrow morning, we've got a big group. It won't take long at all. But that's at 11 o'clock tomorrow. Also, there are right many Christmas cards that are left in the mailboxes back here. If you are back looking at your mailbox and you see a box that has a lot of Christmas cards in it, you recognize the name, use it as an opportunity maybe to take them out if it's somebody that has been sick, been ill, whatever reason. Maybe they just haven't been here for a while. We encourage you, grab those Christmas cards and maybe stop and make a visit and say, we've missed you. Hope you're feeling better. Here are Christmas cards that members have blessed you with. Opportunities, that's what we're looking at. Any announcements, further announcements? Okay, this coming Saturday at 9 o'clock, we will take down the Christmas trees. So, again, opportunity for service and fellowship and a good time. Odell Hedrick. Odell went in for a procedure last week. Odell's been having trouble with breathing in his lungs and had a little bit of infection in there, but they ended up doing a procedure, went in, irrigated, Won't get into a lot of details, but he is feeling much better now. He is, as of right now, his CO2 levels are a little bit high, and they're going to take him into intensive care for a time. Basically, it's just for a procedure to help rid his body of some of the CO2. So keep Odell and family in prayers too. Okay, we're looking at the new year. Let's start off by opening our worship service by singing hymn, O Come All Ye Faithful, number 145. As we come into God's presence this morning, we are given an opportunity to speak with our Creator, our Heavenly Father, one-on-one. It is truly a blessing. It is something that we take for granted. As believers, we are encouraged to go to God with our concerns, with our needs, with our supplication, with our rejoicing. We are called to come into His presence. Nothing more that God likes anymore than for us to come to Him as our Creator and our Father. So let's start with our individual prayers this morning, and then we'll lead into the corporate prayer. There are names that have already been mentioned. The family of Kay Cook, Keep Odell, in our prayers, not only today, but this coming week as he recovers. There's a lot of illness out there. There's a lot of flu. There's a lot of RSV, all those things that are going around this year. There are lonely hearts out there. Whenever we enter the holiday season, we enter it with rejoicing. But it's also a time that we remember, and there's those loved ones that have gone on ahead of us. There are issues in our own life of broken relationships, of difficulties. And the good Lord has said, come to me,
Come to me and I'll bring you comfort. I'll bring you understanding. I'll bring you hope. But above all, I'll bring you the promise of all eternity. And as we come into his presence this morning, let's remember those things. Let us pray. Father God, only you are good. You sent your Son into our midst for a single holy purpose. And that was that our relationship with you, Father, would be repaired. It would be restored. It would be recreated, Father, because of a great sacrifice that you would send to us. And Father, you sent to us only your best, your only Son, your perfectly innocent Son, Father, that he might be the living sacrifice that was required to cleanse our sins, our iniquities, those things that we have done wrong, those things that we have failed to do in your name, Father. And Lord, we celebrate that gift, even in the midst of this season, as we continue with Christmas and the Christmas story, we celebrate that tremendous gift. Father, we also look to the future. For today is the end of one of our calendar years. Tomorrow becomes a new day and a new year. We have no idea what lies ahead, Father. But we know that you have promised us, irregardless of what that might be, good times, difficult times, struggles, praising, whatever it might be, Father, you have promised us your presence. And we pray that in our hearts, Father, we might come to rejoice each and every day, that we would celebrate your great love for us, that we would look to you for guidance, that you would lead us into those areas for your purposes, Father, that your kingdom might be spread, that others might come to know your Son, might come to know him and worship him and serve him. Father, for the names that we have mentioned this morning and all those names that are on each member's hearts, I pray, Lord, that you would meet the needs of each one according to your will, so that they might know you, so that they might feel love that you have shared with all of us. We pray that as our country goes into a new year, Father, I pray that you would open the eyes of our leaders, that they would seek you in all things, that they would come to serve you, that they would come to acknowledge you. And I pray, Father, that you would keep your hand upon this country, that we might be truly shining light on a hill, that others might come to know you. Father, and for all these blessings, we give you thanks, and we remember the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and glory. Amen. Let us continue our worship service with giving of our tithes and our offerings. Our Father God, in the midst of this season, we give you thanks for that gift, the tremendous gift that you gave us. But Father, we also remember those blessings that you shower upon us each and every day of our lives. We pray that you would take these, our offerings, that you would bless them and multiply them so that they might be effective in spreading your word, your holy gospel. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Scripture this morning comes from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. This ends the reading of our scripture.
Thank you, Shirley. Tina, thank you so much. You have truly a gift. That was beautiful, absolutely beautiful. We come here this morning. I wish you a happy new year. Although we're not quite there yet, we still are winding down to that moment when glass balls drop and we see a change in a calendar and we hear the page of the calendar tear off, and all of a sudden, within a matter of seconds, we're looking at a brand new year. A new year, new beginnings. An evaluation of where we have been and where we have come from. This year, along about October, when we look at Christmas, we think of Christmas. There's always preparations. We start getting excited as we approach Christmas. And I don't have to tell any of you, from the time when I was very young until now, Christmas was a December event. As we started approaching Christmas time, the signs went up, the glittery decorations went up. This year, when I went to Lowe's before Halloween, they had already started putting up Christmas trees. They totally were discounting the Halloween event. So they were starting, for probably selfish reasons, taking advantage of people's good nature and desire to buy and to spread good cheer, I guess, with gifts. People start preparing for Christmas early now. When we look at the original Christmas story, we know the scripture in Luke, we know the scripture in Matthew, and we know the events that started unfolding actually quite suddenly. That was to mankind. But God had already started preparing for Christmas. God started preparing for Christmas all the way back thousands of years prior to. Whenever we look at the book of Genesis, there's actually a mention in Genesis how Christ would come. His name was not given, but it was used in terms of Christ would come and crush the head of the serpent, which was the evil one. But the serpent would turn around and injure the Christ, indeed injuring. So the preparations were there. The clues were given down through the centuries. When we look at Old Testament scripture, we know all of the prophecies that were made. Indeed, whenever Christ was born, it started the fulfillment of over 200 prophecies. What we're looking at today, last Sunday, is we were looking at poverty, promises, and purposes. We stopped somewhat in the middle of the nativity scene. You know, we talked about the shepherds coming out of the fields, and they came and they found the babe, and they found Mary and Joseph there in the stable, and we stopped there. Today we're looking at a continuation of that scene. And whenever we look at the nativity scene, we have had a way over the years as humanity of condensing things, consolidating things. In so doing, we've taken away some of the events. And when we look back at that nativity scene and we see the shepherds who came, the shepherds, some of society's lowest esteemed people, People who know loneliness, isolation, rejection, and they have just reported the appearance of a multitude of angels over the shepherd's fields announcing the birth of a Savior, their son, Jesus. They had to come and see for themselves, and visit they did and worship they did, for they knew they were in the presence of the Messiah, the very Word of God, the promise of God kept, the predictions of the prophets fulfilled, the light of the world, the bread of life, Emmanuel, God with us. That is what the shepherds came for, to worship. As we read the scriptures and ponder the story of Christ's birth, there's information in both the Gospel of Luke and the Gospel of Matthew regarding the events of Messiah's birth, and we know all those because down through the years we've celebrated them. And as we celebrate the birth of Christ in nativity plays, in dramas, in presentations, we have a tendency to take those actual details of his birth and morph them, change them into a single event that's easier to understand, maybe easier to present. As we look at the nativity scene, there's the baby Jesus, the parents, Mary and Joseph, the shepherds, the magi or the wise men, and the animals of the stall. We know that. If you look on our lawn this morning, you'll see a nativity set that has all of those characters. In condensing the details into a single gathering, though, we're actually presenting a bit of misinformation. The shepherds of the fields arrived on the night of Christ's birth, according to Scripture in Luke 2. They came immediately after the angels' announcement, after the angels had revealed what was about to happen. And immediately the shepherds came and they found the baby. And upon finding him, they worshipped him. In the Gospel of Matthew 2, it states, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose, and we have come to worship him. The arrival of the magi occurred some time after the birth of Christ. According to Scripture, it may have happened as much as 2 years after the Nativity. When the Magi came, whatever time frame it was, they entered Jerusalem unannounced. They just suddenly showed up. And immediately the people of Jerusalem recognized these strangers as someone they didn't know, but it was men that they could tell were of importance and value. It caused quite a stir. Being men of obvious importance asking questions about a new king, they were assuredly sent directly to the palace of King Herod. And as they asked King Herod about this new king, the emotions of Herod were greatly aroused. He first asked the Magi, when did this star appear? He had already established his ruthlessness and his paranoia in protecting his royal powers. He had murdered sons, wives, and all manner of political opponents. Herod was a man unwilling to tolerate any threat, real or perceived, to his throne or his power. He would deal with this threat quickly and decisively. His command to the Magi was to go to Bethlehem, find the young child, then return to him and give him directions to where the child was. Clearly, this reveals how King Herod intended to deal with this new king. In Matthew 2:3, another curious detail about the citizens of Jerusalem is revealed. When you read Matthew, the second chapter, the third verse, it says, when King Herod heard this, and in this it is that a new king had been born, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem was with him. That's strange. Why would all of Jerusalem be disturbed? Wasn't a large part, a portion of Jerusalem, the children of Israel? Was it not the Jewish leaders? Was it not the leaders of the people who knew the Torah? They knew the law. They knew the writings. Yet they were disturbed. Did they not have expectations of a coming Messiah? We know that it had been 400 years since God had spoken to the Jewish people. It was the time of silence. We know about it. And it was the last moment was when God spoke to his prophet Malachi. But it had been 400 years ago. And we remember how Malachi warned the people of a coming Messiah. And he also warned them of their hard-heartedness. So what have the people of Jerusalem and the greater kingdom been doing in those 400 years? Malachi had told them there will be a forerunner. And all of the prophecies were pointing towards the coming of a Messiah. Yet, the people were not taking this time to be expectant, to study, to find knowledge, to find truth. Even the leaders of the day had not been watchful, had not been vigilant. The people had been overrun by the Persian Empire. We know that. They had been overrun by the Greeks in 333 years before Christ. 10 years later, it fell to the Egyptians. But then in 2004, 200 years before Christ, it fell to the Syrians. But then, 63 years before Christ was born, it fell to the Romans. And the table is set according to God's purposes, according to God's plan. The table is set. The Romans have taken over, and they have now set up their kingdom. During this time, though, the Jewish people were guilty of mistreating their wives, marrying pagans, and not tithing. The priests were neglecting the temple and not teaching the people the ways and the requirements of God. It even mentions that the sacrifices that were being made, and the sacrifices had to be made according to Levitical law and Mosaic law. A sacrifice was only to be without defect, without blemish. And even the priests were using animals that had defects, that had less value. So when we hear in Scripture that the people of Jerusalem, when they heard of a new king and they started hearing Messiah, even the people were disturbed. And then we return to the Magi. In Matthew 2:11, it states, and they're talking about the Magi. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. And let me pause there for a minute. On coming to the house, they saw the child, not the baby, the child. And the child was with his mother. And when they came, they didn't come to the stable. They came to the house. So Scripture here indicates that the Magi came on a time frame when the baby Jesus was likely a toddler, which is a little bit outside of the realm of what we typically consider. But when the Magi come and they bring with them gold, which indicates a king. The king has instruments and has objects of gold. Frankincense, which is the incense that is reserved for those who are kingly. And then myrrh. And myrrh is somewhat of a precursor, which is used a lot of times for preparations of bodies at burial. But the Magi indeed found the king they were looking for. After being warned in the dream, in a dream from God, they returned home by a route that took them away from King Herod's palace and took them away from his evil intentions. So we see it's a story we're familiar with. But immediately after the Magi's departure, God came to Joseph in a dream, and God warned he and Mary that they were to leave and they were to take the child and they were to go to Egypt because God forewarned them. Herod is about to do something that is unthinkable. You see, Herod, in an attempt to eliminate this potential threat to his power, to his kingdom, sends out that edict, that directive, that all of the firstborn male babies, the firstborn in the town of Bethlehem and the surrounding area, all of them are to be wiped out. They're to be destroyed. Unthinkable. But Herod, in his furiousness, thought that he had eliminated the threat. And because of God's protection, he didn't. But then when we look in Jeremiah, the 31st chapter, the 15th verse, there was a prediction in Jeremiah about this very event. A voice is heard in Ramah, weeping in great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children and refusing to be comforted because they are no more. In Luke, the 2nd chapter, the 21st verse, we are told, on the 8th day when the child was circumcised, in accordance with God's covenant with Abraham, he was given the name Jesus, just as the angel had instructed before he was conceived. And then on the 40th day, as was customary, as was directed, Mary and Joseph took Jesus to the temple for their process, their rite of purification. Both the child had to be purified, and Mary, as the mother, had to be purified. And how did that occur? Sacrifices were made. And it tells us Mary offered two doves, one as a burnt offering, as an honor to God for the child born, and one as a sin offering in confession of sin and repentance and for the actual rite of purification. And we think about this and we go, wait a minute, if a sacrifice is being offered for the baby Jesus, why would that be? This child is without sin. This child has done nothing wrong. This child would live a life without any guilt. But you see, it is done so that, according to Scripture, that the Christ might fulfill all righteousness. He was guilty of no sin, and yet because of those that he would go to the cross for, he took on this right to acknowledge that he would take on the sin. And as the child and the young parents are leaving, a devout and righteous man named Simeon enters the temple. The Holy Spirit had revealed to Simeon that he would not die before he had seen the consolation of Israel, the Messiah. And now as he went up to the young couple, Mary and Joseph, he took the baby Jesus and he held him up and he gave thanks to God for his faithfulness. And he said to God, "Take your servant. My life has been fulfilled. For you have been faithful, God, in letting me see the Messiah that you promised." And as we look, there's also a prophetess there named Anna. Anna lives in the temple. She had been married and her husband died at a young age. She was 84 years old. And she lived and she prayed and she fasted within the temple every day. And when she saw Simeon and she saw the young couple, she came over. And she lifted up God's name and she gave thanks because this was the child, this was the Messiah that had been promised. God had been faithful and loyal in sending the Messiah. And as we know, as all of these events unfold, they unfold underneath the radar. The people of Jerusalem, they're disturbed, they're upset, yet their lives go on. The priests have fallen into complacency. They are not worshiping God according to how they have been called to worship. And yet, the promise of God is quietly being fulfilled in their very presence, and they don't even realize it. And so begins the life of our Messiah and our Savior, Jesus Christ, the Lamb, the Redeemer, the Bread of Life, our King Eternal. And as we look at the story, we remember, we back away from the story, and it's a story that we're all familiar with. But it's a story that we ponder when we look at all the predictions, all the prophecies that were made during Old Testament times. When we look at the book of Daniel, and Daniel prophesied about a coming Messiah. In various places in the Old Testament, they spoke God's word, God's promises to the people of their day. I want us to ponder that for a moment. Because you see, those same scriptures, those same words from God that were spoken through his prophets, they talk about this great event of the Messiah coming. And in many of those same Old Testament prophecies, they talk about another event. They talk about the second coming, when Christ would return, when he would return, this time not as a baby, not as a sacrifice, but he will come as a lion who will lead his people to the victory, to the eternal reward that through Jesus' heavenly Father, our God, has promised. Whenever we ponder the Christmas story, we look and we go, how could the people have missed it? There were clear prophecies about when this would happen or the event that would happen, and were they not vigilant? Were they not watching? Guess what? not sure our society is watching. As a matter of fact, I know they were not. In the book of Daniel, in the final chapters of Daniel, it talks about the second coming in Daniel. And Daniel was 600 years before the birth of Christ. We know the book of Revelation. We know parts of it. Do we study it? The book of Revelation is actually a book of hope for God's people. It is a book that describes some very difficult times for those who have failed to watch for the second coming. And we remember whenever we look at those priests in Jerusalem that were disturbed during the 400 years that they led the people, and they slowly became complacent, even to the point of being apathetic. And they heard that the new king is coming, the Messiah is here. And they were concerned. They were worried. As we look to the new year, we look with joy. We have been blessed. Each one of us has been blessed. This church has been blessed. We have been blessed with dear friends. We have been blessed with family. We have been blessed by a community that lives in peace for the most part. We are blessed by God. He calls us to serve Him now. Tomorrow we start a new year, a time of new beginnings. Today is our day of reflection. Where have we come from this year, and how did we get to where we are right now? And then we ponder, how did we serve this past year of the Christ child? How have we been blessed? How have we taken Christ's blessings and His word and His good news and His gospel to those around us? How have we shown God's grace to others as Christ did in difficult circumstances? So that those around us, family, friends, strangers, might come to trust Christ and eventually serve Him. How have we trusted Him? How have we shown our adoration for this young babe, this small toddler, this young adult, this man of God that had no place to lay his head during his place here on earth, who walked into the midst of some of the most difficult circumstances that were ever created, who lived his life knowing full well what the final moments of his life would look like. He was willing to do that for you and for me, so that we might have eternal joy, so that we might live in an eternal relationship with our Heavenly Father. It's actually a time of great joy. This gift has been given to us. All we have to do is unwrap it, ponder it, understand it, and receive it. So now, I want to close with a short piece of scripture, and it comes from 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, the 18th verse. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Tonight, as we wrap up 2023 and we look to a new year, I want us to be full of joy, be optimistic, be full of expectations. Expectations that God will work through us, that God will place opportunities in front of us, that we would serve Him. And most of those opportunities will be in a moment of quietness, in a conversation. Most likely it will not be in a room full of people. It'll simply be sharing a story. Sharing your story. With those people around us that we run into that have no hope, they're looking for an answer. And these people come from all areas of life. They can be an acquaintance, they can be a family member, it can be a total stranger. As you walk into a restaurant, and there's a lady sitting on the bench next to the door crying. It might mean stepping out of our comfort zone. And it will. But it's trusting God that you can say, I noticed that you're dealing with something. Can I help in any way? Your words, your 10 minutes spent might change someone's life. That's what God calls us to do. He calls us to very simply, very trustingly, share with others the good news of that child and God's salvation for all of our lives. As we enter the new year, I pray that each of us sets our sights, our purposes, and our lives on those things unseen and eternal. May we bring glory to Him, the young child that came to us. May we truly serve that child of eternity. In Christ's holy name, I pray. Amen. And now let us continue our service with our closing hymn, Good Christian Men Rejoice, number 151. In our Sunday school class this morning, as we were finishing up, last Sunday I mentioned the term Migdal Eater. I don't know if any of you had a chance to take a look at it, to Google it. Some of the guys in our class did. It is amazing, which is pretty much what they reported. But Christ has good news for us, for our lives. Even in moments of difficulty, when we lift up thanks to God, maybe in moments even that we don't feel like we're blessed, whenever we lift up those blessings, those thanks to Him, those are the very thanks that carry the most weight, irregardless of circumstances. As we look at our new year, I wish everyone a happy new year. I wish you much prosperity. I wish you much happiness. And I pray that in all those circumstances, we will come to know Christ better, that we will serve Him in a deeper sense of His calling. And I pray that you would have a great year. In Christ's holy name, amen.